So this class will also be on the group or on YouTube. Okay, so looking at the first one, they ask you to calculate the effective interest rate if the investment earns interest at a rate of 11.5% per annum monthly compounded. So let's just quickly talk about effective and nominal again, so that we all understand it perfectly. Right. I have an example here. I explained it to a kid yesterday, but it was Afrikaans, but I just need the numbers there, so you can just look here. Where did I write it now? Alright. So if we think about the nominal interest rate, you need to understand that a nominal interest rate has got compoundings. Okay, so it's 12% compounded monthly, 12% compounded quarterly, 12% compounded daily, whatever. Okay, where an effective rate does not have compoundings because it is effectively what the interest rate is for 12 months. Okay, for a year. So if I tell you you have an interest rate of 12% per annum, semi-annually. That means in 6 months' time you will receive 6% of the interest rate. And then at 12 months you will receive another 6%. But you need to understand that that 6% will not just be on the amount that you invested, it will also be on the 6% interest you've already received. So you're receiving 6% plus 6% plus 6% of 6%. Does that make sense? Okay. So effectively, you are earning more than 12%. Right? That's why we have this formula to do the calculation, to calculate how much interest rate will you actually receive if you receive 12% compounded annually. Right? So I did an example here. I said if you go to bank A and they tell you that they can give you an interest rate of 11.5% compounded monthly, and the bank B says that you can receive interest rate of 12% compounded semi-annually, then you don't know who's actually giving you the greater interest rate. Because this one has got 12 compoundings and this one has got 2 compoundings in a year. So what we do when we compare these two is we try to get them level. We want to know what are they actually effectively. In other words, what's the actual interest rate you earn per year? So I use my formula and then I find with 11.5% compounded monthly, you are actually getting 12.1259% annually. If you earn 12% semi-annually, you can substitute into your formula and then you will see you are actually receiving 12.36% annually. So these two values are effectively what you get if that is offered. 11.5% monthly and 12% semi-annually. Do you understand why we're doing effective and nominal? Alright. And now, the other way around that we can calculate it, if they tell you, you are getting 12% effectively, but you say, I want to receive my interest monthly. Okay, I want to get it every month. What is the nominal rate, compounded monthly, that is the equivalent of 12% annually? Then they're giving you the effective, right? 12%. You want it monthly, so your compoundings will be divided by 12 to the power of 12. And then you just swap around in the formula, and then you will see that if you have to get 12% annually, but you want it in monthly compoundings, you will only be able to receive 11.5% per year compounded monthly. So you're not actually getting 11.5% because you're getting interest every month. Therefore, actually at the end of the year, you will have received 12%. Okay. So the first question, they gave you the nominal rate of 11.5% compounded monthly, and they want to know what is it effectively. So you just substitute into the formula. Remember, with nominal and effective, the number of years do not play a role. You just want to find out what is it actually worth per year. So don't confuse that n dividing with n and to the power of n with years multiplying with something. It's just the compoundings and the compoundings. And then when you calculate it, you get 0.12125. Do not forget that we still need to multiply it with 100. And then I get 12.1%. If you rounded it off to 12.13%, then that's fine as well. Any questions? Okay, the next one, they said Karabu bought a computer for 4,700 Rand, and then the value of this computer decreased with 18% per annum. You had to calculate the amount after 5 years using the reduced balance depreciation. So what I wrote here, A equal to P bracket 1 minus N. This is the straight line depreciation. That's like simple interest. There's nothing said about the straight line depreciation there. Some way that they hide the fact that it's straight line is they can tell you that the value at the end of this term is zero. Because remember, a straight line can go down to zero, where an exponential graph will only near zero, but it won't touch zero. So keep that in mind. Né? The second formula I have here is for the reduced balance depreciation. And that formula looks exactly like the compound interest formula, except it has a minus, both of them. Okay. So they are obviously and very clearly telling us it must be reduced balance. So I'm going to use this second formula. I just substitute into it 4,700 Rand. That's the amount that we start with. The cost of it today, I want to know the cost after 4 years. So 4 years later will be the future value. So I expect this value to be less than 4,700 Rand. And then you get 2,124 Rand and 77 cents. Then we spoke about 7.3 in class yesterday. I told you that this is a different way of them asking it. So the first question was they wanted the value after 2 years, and the last question was they wanted the value at the end of, what was it, 7 years. Okay. So I drew the whole timeline. Okay. We draw the line to get the number of years. Okay. I read the whole question before I started drawing it because you didn't know it's 7 years at the beginning, eh? The deposit or withdrawals was a 20,000 Rand deposit at the beginning. And then 4 years later, there was a withdrawal of 2,500 Rand. Okay. Interest rate for the first 2 years, 7.2% quarterly. For the remaining 5 years, 7.8% compounded monthly. So to calculate the value at the end of 2 years, you're going to ignore the other years after 2 years. You just jump in here, there's only one deposit or withdrawal, and you swim up to 2 years and you get out. So therefore, it's just going to be 20,000, 1 plus 0.072 over 4 to the power of 2 times 4, and I get 23,068 Rand and 12 cents. How did I know I'm going to calculate A? Because of what I read in the question. They said an initial or original amount or deposit was made of 20,000 Rand. This is not a deposit on a car. They deposited the money into the account, right? So you have the original amount. You need to calculate the final amount. So spend time to make sure you have to calculate A or B. Right, the next question, they wanted you to find the future value after 7 years. Now, I said to you guys yesterday, you can now take this one and go on with it. But I would rather have taken the whole thing from the start, just to be safe. But it doesn't matter. I think, Sia, you said you'd use that one and you were able to get it perfectly right. That's good. You must just not confuse yourself whether you're going to add something now or you're going to multiply something now and when you're adding then afterwards. Okay, so if I take the full 7 years, I'm jumping in with 20,000. I've got my first bracket for 7.2 quarterly, and then I've got my second bracket for 7.8 monthly, right? This was for 2 years, 2 times 4, and the second one was for 5 years, times 12 for monthly compounding. Then I'm out of the pool. Then I go in again at minus 2,500. Minus 2,500 only had one interest rate, so it will only have one bracket. And then I get to an answer, final answer, at the end of 7 years of 30,871.48. Any questions on the finances? You are going to do the next question 7 today in class, so you will have another opportunity to just make sure that you are able to understand everything. Okay. Then we go to the statistics. So the first question, they wanted you to set up a cumulative frequency table, but I told you can just write the values there. Just remember the first cumulative frequency is 16. Okay? So it's this one plus whatever is above it, and there's nothing above it, so it's 16. Plus 26, 42. Plus 42 is 84. Plus 54 is 138. Plus 26 is 164. Plus 22 is 186. Plus 14 is 200. Okay. Then you had to draw a GIF for the data on the roster which was not given. Okay. Now, when we draw the GIF, it's important firstly to know which axis is which one. What will the cumulative frequency always be? Always the y-axis. Don't ever confuse that. So cumulative frequency is always the y-axis. Looking at my cumulative frequency, the smallest value I need is 16, and the biggest value I need is 200, so I cannot really skip values. Né? 16 is small and 200 is big. So I decided to draw my y-axis and count in 20s. Okay, it doesn't matter if you count it in 10s or in 15s or whatever, that's fine. I don't think you can count in like 50s, right? Because then your graph won't be very accurate. The next one are the lengths that I have to calculate. And this I get from the intervals, right? So remember, I am going to need my smallest interval value, the smallest one in the first one, because that's where my anchor goes. And then I'm going to need the upper values of the interval up to 181. Right. So I drew this on the x-axis. Now, just to show you, I did that zigzag just to show I'm squishing the graph in, because from 0 to 118, nothing is happening. And I don't want to count in hundreds, because then I will just have one unit from 100 to 181. So I did it like this. I counted in 10, keeping this first part. All clear on that. What do I use to plot my points? These values, the second values in the interval, and the cumulative frequency. So the first one I plotted was 127 and 16. 136 and 42. 145 and 84. 154 and 138. 163 and 164, 172 and 186, and then my final one was 181 and 200. And you guys remember I told you, you can add more points that you've plotted, but I always plot that last one. You join the points, and a mark is given for the anchor to the original first value of the interval. So I anchor it to 180. The next question that asks you to use the ogive to find the lowest quartile, the lower quartile, the median, and the upper quartile. Now you remember the way we did this is we found the positions. So I say 200 plus 1, which is 202, times a quarter. That gives me position 50.25. Then I say 201 times a half. This is for Q2. I get 100.5. Then I say 201 times 3 quarters. Then I get 150.75. These are positions. It's not the values. Okay, now I take these positions and I go to the ogive. I first make the reading from 50.25, so you can see it's not accurate 100%. So I draw the line from there, I hit the ogive, and it's like it's reflecting it down. And I got 138 for Q1. Then at 100.5, to the ogive, down, I got round about 148. And then 150.75 to the ogive, reflected down, I got around about 158. Q1, Q2, and Q3. Any questions on these? Yeah. Remember, I'm now drawing mine on not on a scale, also in my book. So therefore, I can't even know if mine is 100% correct. Okay? But normally with the value that they give us, depending on how big these values are. You understand? So if we're like talking about thousands or ten thousands that we're counting in, they might give you a smaller range. But for this, it might be two more, two less. Was yours much bigger or much smaller, or was it round about there? Round about there. Okay. Now then... It will. Okay, but normally, because we all know that this, with these values, because it's sorted data, because of the interval, everything is estimate. Okay, where if we have the ungrouped data, we know that this is exactly Q1. It's 24. That's that specific number there in your line. That was Q1. This is an estimate value of where it will be. It will be surprisingly accurate, but it's not exactly that value. Okay, the next one that asked you to comment on the spreading of this is the lens of the learners. Okay, now I wanted to do this one with you, and I told you this yesterday, because you remember if you have to comment on it, you actually need the box and whisket diagram, do you agree with me, to see which side is pulling it up or down. And if you don't have the box and whisker diagram, you need the mean and the median. Because if the mean is going to be smaller than the median, it's skewed to the left. If the mean is bigger than the median, it's skewed to the right. And if the mean and the median are equal, it's a normal spread. Okay, so please, everyone, we are going to calculate the mean of this set of data. Because this one we haven't done in a while. We start by clearing them. Clear all. Now don't type yet. Just quickly look here on the board for me. If we are working with unsorted data, okay, so there's not an interval. those specific values. What we would do is we would go to mode. Don't press now because we're not going to do this one. We'd go to stat. We'd choose number one for VIR. Then we would have our one column, X. And we would submit the values in there. Do you remember that? And then we can calculate the mean and the standard deviation. Right. We practiced quite a few of them. But we didn't practice a lot of them where we have an interval. Right, so let's just make our plans first. If we want to submit something with an interval, we first have to get the middle value of this interval. Now to do that, if you can't see, if it was 10 and 20, then it's easy most to see the middle value will be 15. Right? But these ones are a little bit tricky. So if you're unsure, you just want to make sure you're on the right track, you add the 2 and you divide it by 2. Okay? That's how you get the middle value of two values. So you can say 118 plus 127 equal to, and then divide by 2, you get 122.5. Okay? So what we did yesterday as well, we saw that the middle value will be 4.5 more than that one. That will be the same for everyone. Okay? So I didn't go and add the others. We just added 4.5 to all of them. So this will be 131.5. But just make sure, Nick, because if you make a mistake here, everything is going to be wrong. This one will be 140.5. This one will be 149.5. This one will be 158.5. This one will be 167.5. And this one will be 176.5. Those are the middle values. Alright, now back to the calculator. I need two columns. Because I need to submit these values, the lengths, and then I also need to submit the frequency of those values. So how many people were 122.5 estimate? How many people were 31, and so on. So back to the calculator, I'm just going to clear mine first, right? We need to put the frequency on first. Can you remember how to put the frequency on? Okay, we press shift and then set up. Then there's nothing about statistics there, we go down. Then we see at number 3 it says stat. I choose number 3 and it asks frequency on or off. I press 1 because I want my frequency on. Now everything I do is exactly the same. It's only that little part that is extra for me to find the, or to switch the frequency on. So I'm going to start, go back to mode, stat, choose VIR, and now I've got my two columns. Now in the X column, I'm going to say 122.5 equal to 131.5 equal to 140.5. 140.5, then 149.5. 158.5, 167.5, and 176.5. Now I just want to check my values. Okay, now I put my frequencies in, not the cumulative frequency. Okay? Cumulative means all of the values up to that one. I'm putting in this frequency I see here in the table given. So it's 16 equal to 26 equal to 42 equal to 54 equal to 26 equal to 22 equal to 14 equal to. If you made a mistake with one of them, you just go so that it is highlighted again and then you just re-enter it. You don't have to redo everything. Okay, are you done? So once everything is in there, I clear my calculator. And then our calculations are done with this bottom stat, ne? So I'm going to press shift, stat, choose VAR again. Now remember, what I actually want to calculate here is the mean, because I want to compare it to the median. So the mean is number 2, and I get 148.15. The median I found was round about 148. So I've got 148 and 148.15. Can you see that I can therefore say that this set of data is normal, skewed normally? Because the mean and the median are both at 148. And once again, remember, these are estimate values. If it was exactly 148 and exactly 148, and that was the actual values, or the one was 149, then you can even say skewed to the right. But this, because it's estimate, we consider this as a normal set of data. Now, just to recap on this, if the question also asked for the standard deviation, I would go back to number 1, choose VAR again, and then remember we choose number 3. That gives me the standard deviation of 14.5. Do you all understand that? Okay. So you must be able to do both. Frequency on, and then the normal one with frequency off. The next question asked, round about how many learners will be between 138 and 158 centimeters long? Now, if you look at my Q1 and my Q3, do you see it's the number of learners between 138 Q1 and 158 Q3? Now, even if yours has a difference of 1 or 2 or whatever, it will also be somewhere around there. So do you agree with me, between Q1 and Q3, that's a quarter of the data and that's 3/4 of the data. How many data or how much data is between a quarter and 3/4? Not the number of data, what percentage? From a quarter to 3/4. It's 50%, half of the data. Now, they're not asking what percentage of the data. They're asking how many learners. How many learners? So if there were 200 learners in this experiment or whatever, and you are telling me that 50% of the learners lie between 138 and 158, do you agree with me? We can say 100 learners are lying between them. Because 50% of 200 is 100. Do you understand it? Okay. Point 1 asks, which values are the same for both classes? It's the median and the maximum value. The median and the maximum value are the same for those two box and whiskers. There's the median and there's the maximum. Then they said the teacher says that because the medians are the same, she thinks there's no difference in the marks of the learners of the two classes. They pretty much did the same. Okay, now let's talk about this, because this is also something that you must be able to do. You have to be able to explain the results that you see. I hope that you all disagree with this teacher when you look at these two box and whisker diagrams. These two classes didn't do basically the same. How did they differ? How can you say that? And this is important. It's not just that there was one learner here at the class A that maybe is an outlier that did very bad. What we see here is that the learner in the B class that had the worst performance, eh? She did the baddest. 25% of learners in the A class performed worse than she did, or he did. So the worst performance in class B is better than 25% of the learners in class A. Do you understand that? Another thing that we can see, or that we can say, is the whole of class B performed above 68%. Do you see that? Everyone is above 68%. Where only 75% of class A got more than 68. 25% of them got less than 68. So do you understand how to give your answers? You cannot just say, no, she's not right because class B did better than class A. That's not efficient. You need to tell us why do you say that, using the measures of tendency and of central that we see here. Okay, determine if the minimum or maximum values of class A are outliers. Now, I specifically want us to look at this question again. This you have to study. It's a formula you need to know. How do we calculate the borders for the outliers? You're going to need Q1, Q2, or well, actually just Q1 and Q3 for that. Okay, so what I started with, I wrote down a 5-number summary. Now, why am I saying I need Q1 and Q3? Because you're going to need the IQR, the interquartile range. Interquartile range is Q3 minus Q1, and that gives me 22. And then the formula to calculate those borders, for the lower border, it's going to be Q1 minus 1.5 or 3/2 times the IQR. For the upper border, it's Q3 plus 3/2 times IQR. Okay, look at me. There's nothing to understand. There's nothing to understand that Q1 minus 3/2 times IQR is the lower border and Q3 plus 3/2 times IQR is the upper border. Nothing to understand. You have to learn it, right? Once you've learned it, you will be able to write it down and substitute. What we're doing here mathematically is just grade 8 substitution. But you cannot do the substitution if you haven't learned the formula, okay? So I substitute Q1, 68, minus 3/2 times 22. And I substitute Q3, 90 plus 3/2 times 22. And the two border values I get is 35 and 123. The minimum value, I only know what the minimum value and what the maximum value is. I don't know other values in between them. That's why the question asks you to determine whether the minimum or the maximum is perhaps the outlier. So if this is the border, is the minimum value of class A an outlier? Why are you saying no, Sia? The border is 35. The lowest value, the minimum value, is 30. So you see it's outside of the border. The minimum is an outlier. The upper border is 123. What's the highest, the maximum I have there? 98. Is 98 an outlier? No, because it's inside of the border. So therefore, to answer the question, the minimum of 30 is an outlier. want to put the two box and whiskers up there. At number 5.4, they asked you to comment on the marks of Class A. So I want to show you what we're going to do, what we're going to say here. Firstly, let's look at the skewness first. I think that's the easiest one to comment. Do you see that the median is here at 80? And the lower 50% is pulled much lower. The range of the lower 50% is going to be 50, and the range of the upper 50% is going to be 18. You see that? So can we make a safe assumption that this thing is skewed to the left? It's pulling it down. Okay, that's one thing I can comment on. Something else that I can comment on when I look at that is I can see, because I cannot comment on the mean. You agree with me? I don't have a mean. Right? I can comment on the range, because I have the minimum and the maximum. Right? The range of Class A is quite deep. The range is 68% or 68 marks. What does that mean? It means the data or the values, the marks are spread out quite far from each other. Okay. Something else that I can comment on is either going to be, you can make a comment about Q1, Q2, and Q3. So what will I comment on? If I comment on Q1, I will say that it's not really an explanatory comment if I say 25% has got less than 68. Think about your marks now. If I tell you 25% of the class got less than 68, it doesn't have the punch as me saying 75% of the class 11B got above 68 for the test. Can you hear the punch that has? 75% of the class did better than 68 out of 100. Okay, that's what Q1 tells us. So you're going to have to consider which side you want to use it to. Am I going to say, let's say Q1 was at 90%. I would say only 25% of the learners got less than 90%. 75 performed above 90%. You understand how to comment? If I look at Q2, I can say half of the class got a distinction for this test. Half of the class performed above 80%. That's impressive, ne? You hear the punch. Me saying half of the class got less than 80 has no punch. Then Q3, 90%. Using the bottom mark won't be the punch. 75% performed lower than 90% doesn't give a punch. But saying 25%, a quarter of the class, got more than 90%. That's impressive. That gives a punch. But those are the only things you can comment on. You can only comment on the range, which I get from the higher, the maximum minus the minimum. I can only comment on Q1 and Q2 and Q3. There's one last thing you can comment on that might be the IQR, if you want to say the interquartile range is between 68 and 90, but as you can hear, that doesn't really give us a punch. Doesn't really explain or describe how the learners did in this class. So you must concentrate so that you are able to comment on the data and what it means to you. Because just having the data and sorted doesn't really explain it. If you're going to tell someone who hasn't done statistics that the mean is this and the Q1 is that and Q3 is this and what, it's going to mean nothing to them. So you need to understand what it means so that you can explain and comment in a question on what that actually means. Okay, I'm done with my story today. Are there any questions on this? Please don't just focus on this page for the test on Monday. Okay? Do look at it as well, but don't just focus on this. The test on Monday is not a copy of this. You've also got the old statistics papers in your yellow book. I know we've done it, but you can go and practice it again because it all just stays the same. Finding a cumulative frequency is the same in any question that you find. So practice it. You've now got that second question on the finance, if you haven't done it yet, that you can complete in class now. And I will also send that memo on the group for you so that you can check your answers. Okay? So if you're done with it, you can start studying. If you're not done with it, I hope you now understand everything, and now when you do it, you get everything right. All right, you can start now.